Hey everyone, I'm Philip from PCPartPicker, and I'm here with Ryan.
Hi.
And today we're going to do something a little bit different. We've got a live stream, and this one is about troubleshooting. So sometimes when you do a build, not everything works. You go to boot it up, and well, it just doesn't. We were assembling a bunch of systems and for some projects that we've got kind of coming down the road, and this was one of the systems, so we went to boot it, and well, it wouldn't boot. So we figured, we went through a process to identify what was going on with it and what the problematic component or components were. And as we were going through it, we realized, hey, this would be kind of useful to show on a live stream and show the process and kind of the methodology for troubleshooting. And there's different ways that you can troubleshoot stuff, and some ways are more efficient than others. So we thought that this would be a great kind of test case to show how we go about troubleshooting it.
Yeah.
So in the stream, Ryan basically has chat open. So if you have any questions or anything like that you want to relay, we're happy to chat through it. Obviously, every failure mode or every bad component kind of exhibits different symptoms and different behaviors. So this isn't going to be the universal way of fixing a build. We're just going to take the symptoms that this one shows and go through the process. But the idea is to rather than come up with a checklist that you go through or some big elaborate flowchart, rather to understand kind of the fundamentals of the computer and fundamentals of how to reduce the system down and break out the individual component. So
yeah,
all right. So let's.
We do have a part list for this build, right?
Yes,
I think it's up in the chat if they do exclamation part list.
That's right.
Or parts.
Yeah, or Jack can post it too. We'll see that in just a sec.
Yeah. Should I find you the command? I could do it.
Exclamation part list.
Yeah, it is part list. That's what I thought.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, so that's the part list for the build. Basically, what we've got, that would be a good thing to cover first. So let me see if I can do this. All right, so this is our build right here. What it is we got an ASRock X99 Tai Chi motherboard. Then there's a i7-6800K in the top, a Cryorig cooler. We've got an EVGA G2 550-watt power supply. Then for the drives, which you can't really see, we've got three drives here, one of which is an ADATA 128-gig SSD. And then underneath it are two Samsung 850 Pro 1-terabyte SSDs. And then we've also got 32 gigs of RAM that's basically 16 of which is right here, that you can't really see because of that bar's in the way, and then another 16 gig, which is actually under the cooler back over here. So what we're seeing here is we went to power this thing up and to try it out, and we got the classic symptom where, let's see, is this the power button right here? I can't see from the, is that right there? Other side?
Yeah.
Right there, okay. So we went to power it up, and this is what we got. Fan spin, and then turns off, and then that's it. And if you, where'd that power button go? I can't really see it there. If you hit the power button again, it does nothing. But if you flip the switch on the back of the power supply, turn it off for a second, and then turn it back on, then you click it, it'll power on for just a second. It does it again. So here's what the here's what you see from the inside of the case. So I go to power it on, spins up for just a second, and then shuts off. So that's where we're starting.
Yeah.
What do you think we should do?
Where's the hammer?
Right. No.
No.
So what we want to do is, when we have a situation like this, we want to look at all the components and we want to simplify it as much as possible. So we want to reduce, we've got a lot of connected pieces here. We've got three hard drives, we've got a video card, a pretty large cooler, a lot of RAM, all the stuff that's in this case, and one of these things is likely the faulty component. It could be multiple things, but most likely it's just one.
Right.
And so what we want to do is we want to start reducing things in the build until we get to a point where it's no longer exhibiting the problem. Now, when you have a situation like this where it turns on and it powers off immediately, sometimes there's this kind of this instinctual desire to say, I've got a bad power supply, and I'm going to take the power supply out, I'm going to RMA it, and that's it. And then what happens is you arm A the power supply and it comes back, and then the build does the exact same thing. And you go, oh, well, it must be my motherboard. And so then you take everything apart, you send the motherboard back, get a new motherboard, put it in, same problem happens.
Right.
So before we make any assumptions about what's wrong, we're going to start going through this stuff piece by piece and try to see if it'll reproduce. So first thing, the easiest thing to take out is the video card.
Yep.
Now, we've got this powerhouse of a video card. It's a EVGA GT710. Obviously, we had something right here that was occupying these two slots here, but we took that out. That's a part of our Skunkworks project. So, oh, you know what? Let me
good call.
Do this. So, some people will debate whether this is necessary or not. It certainly can't hurt. And the last thing I want is for the fail component to be because of ESD or because of an intake precautions error.
Right.
All right. So now we have this video card. We're going to take this one out. And again, if you have any questions about this stuff partway through, feel free to just
send ask in the chat and I'll filter it through or I'll answer you.
So we've toggled the power on the thing. There's a clue here and why we have to do this, but we'll get to that later. Obviously, there's some symptoms here that show up in the power supply that kind of give us a little bit of hints that could shortcut the process. But I still want to go through the long version of it so that you can see kind of the full process.
Right.
All right. So we took the video card out. Now we're going to power this thing on again, if I can find the power button.
And when you get a sec, Chad is asking what all the strap is connected to. Obviously,
oh, right.
It's an anti-static strap.
Okay. Yeah, so what we've got here is this strap. There's this little clip here, and this thing will pop off. What that connects to is a little box over on the side here. So basically, behind my drink and behind this focus bar, there's this little block. This plugs into that, and then this cord basically connects up to this mat, which is an anti-static mat, and then this cord also then connects up to the ground. But there's essentially a resistor in series with that, so that if I were to, I don't know, like touch a live 120 volt wire, then I'm not a convenient circuit to ground.
Right.
So instead, with that resistor, you can still, if you touch a live wire by itself, then you're not gonna like. I'm not going to get electrocuted on stream or
right.
anything like that. So that's the anti-static stuff. Now,
we just took the graphics card out.
Yes.
And
okay.
And I think we booted it up and it did the same thing.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. So we show that. So let's do it again. So here we have this. Today.
You got it the right way. Now it's off.
Okay, there we go. Okay.
Further to the right, I think. Oh, right. You got it.
There you go. So it's still powering off by itself. All right, so it's not that. So now the next thing that we're going to do is we're going to keep removing peripherals from this thing. Mm-hmm. The next step is we've got some hard drives. Right?
Yeah.
There's nothing else that we can remove. The CPU and the cooler... those things, if we remove that.
It starts getting labor intensive.
Yeah. Yeah. So we're going to go through the simple stuff first and we're going to keep reducing things down.
Yeah.
All right. So for the hard drives, so we have these and they're in these, basically they're in these caddies that are like some mechanical engineer's like prank. These things are the worst things in the world. They're almost impossible to line up. They're almost impossible to get the
pieces. They look awful.
Yeah.
I've used quite a few of them too. You know, we do all sorts of builds. So,
So we have SSD, all right? So we have the SSD. Then we also have these additional SSDs in here too. And rather than pull those out, I'm just going to disconnect them from the SATA cable and the power. Got that one. Right.
And Dragonlance TV was asking, is this a fresh build or is this an upgrade and we're encountering a problem? So
this is actually a fresh build. We built this thing from scratch and this is the behavior that we saw coming right out of the gate.
Yeah.
And all right. So we've got everything removed. Now, flip switch, hit the power button. Hey.
Yeah, that sounds like a boot.
Look at that. All right. So now this thing is obviously running, and it is not powering off. So there's something with one of our SSDs.
Yeah.
All right. So let's flip the power on that.
We also had a question here from Oferb Herb. Nice name. Why not just reset the CMOS first? It's easy and might fix the problem before you take anything apart.
You could. Well, let's take a step back and kind of talk through the process. So there's two different ways that you can kind of diagnose the problem, and you can try very specific things where you can try resetting the CMOS, but that's one thing, and it only gives you one piece of information. So if you reset the CMOS and it doesn't work, if it does work, then you know it's a CMOS. But if it doesn't work, it doesn't give you any additional information to say, was it the motherboard or
right.
not. So as we are removing these parts, we're simplifying things down. And so if we take out the video card and the problem still exhibits itself, we're almost entirely confident that the video card was not the issue. If we remove one of the SSDs and it still exhibits, then we know that it's likely not that SSD. Eventually, we get to a point to where we simplified it down, and then, boom, it doesn't exhibit itself anymore. So now we can start bringing stuff back in. So we have three SSDs, and we can bring them in one at a time. Mm-hmm. And then every step that we're taking gives us additional information. We've got this thing down to where now we know that it's one of the three hard drives that is causing the issue. So we're going to slowly back these things back in until the problem doesn't exhibit itself anymore.
All right. So let's put that.
And again, if you guys have any questions, just let us know in chat, and we'll do our best to get those answered. Right, I'll relay them along.
So we have these two. So this is one of the SSDs here. And so we're going to plug this guy back in. And get there. There we go. So we got one SSD.
And that's one of our, was that an 850 Pros?
Yeah, it's a 850 1 terabyte SSD.
Okay.
All right, so now we have just one SSD in the system. Then we're going to power this on. And it boots up, and it's running just fine. So we know that SSD is perfectly okay. All right. So now let's go and do the second one.
That's gonna be what is this PC for? It's for an upcoming project. That's all I can say about it right now.
Yeah.
Oh, I like this one. I think it's iMoozel. How would a hard drive affect the whole system? Well, I think you're about to find out.
That's great. Yeah, so that's ultimately what we're trying to figure out. Why would a hard drive prevent the system from booting? And yeah, so we're going to get to that, but piece by piece. All right, so we've put in the second hard drive now, and we'll power this up, or try to. And so that's booting just fine. So we know it's not the second hard drive. So at this point, we have pretty good suspicion that it's this hard drive.
Right.
All right, so what we'll do is I'm just gonna kind of stick it in the top here.
Gosh. Maybe these trays with a passion. Oh my gosh.
Yeah. Like when you get used to working in desktop PCs and then you have to work in like a 4U rack mount case, it's like going back 20 years.
I can't even imagine. I mean, I see it from like $40 budget case to $180, top and enthusiast case. And you're so thankful when you build in those really nice cases that jumping back to server hardware.
Yeah. All right, so we've plugged in our tray, plugged in the power, plugged in the SATA, and now we're going to see if the problem still exhibits itself. So it should if we did everything right the last time. So we go to do this, and then it powers off.
Yeah.
All right, so we know something is going on with this guy. Now, there's two connections here. We have a power and a SATA, and so you could say, well, is the problem with the power or is the problem with the SATA delivery? You can't test the SATA if you unplug the power, so we'll unplug the SATA first to see if removing the SATA, if that does anything to it.
Okay.
So, all right. Turn this on, and nothing. Okay, so now we know there's something with the power on this guy, powering this SSD. So is the SSD failed? Is it faulty? That is a great question.
Yeah.
But the thing is we haven't actually simplified this down all the way.
Right.
There's still, there's actually two pieces in this.
Oh, yeah.
So this SSD is not just an SSD by itself. It's an SSD inside of a tray. So if we want to simplify this down as much as possible, we need to remove the SSD to try to identify if it's really the SSD or the tray that's causing the problem. So we'll take this abomination of a drive sled.
Yeah.
And then...
It's interesting now because most of them... I mean, it's got to be because it has the handle, right? Because the ones now would just mount out at the edge from what I've seen in trays.
Yeah, they have the hot swap base, right. But we didn't really need a...
Right. Yeah, for our project.
Not for this, yeah.
Yeah. Let's see.
Okay.
Is there a way if the hard drive has a problem... I'm going to try to figure out what he's saying. He's missing a word here. I think he's saying, is there a way if the hard drive has a problem that you can figure it out without taking it out like you did? I would imagine that you just unplug the connectors instead of removing it from the system. If I understand the question correctly, it's missing a couple words. So
yeah, you don't have to take it out. I was taking it out of the slide just to kind of show, or I was pulling the whole thing out just to kind of show off the drive itself. Because you can't really see it from the camera angle.
Yeah.
But yeah, you could just disconnect it both from the SATA connector, the data, and the power connector to try that out.
Yeah.
All right, so now we have our SSD by itself. And so to test that out, we're going to plug this in. And then we'll plug in the power. So here you can see that. So now this guy is connected up. And we're going to power it up. Or try to. So,
yep.
What do you know? It boosts just fine.
It's up, yeah.
All right.
There was actually just a question. Someone was asking, do you think it's the cable from the power supply? Well.
So this actually means that, no, it's not the cable from the power supply. Although that's a great thing. I mean, that's a great question to ask.
Yeah.
And that's something that, so we're trying to remove components from the system piece by piece. If you replace the cable from the power supply, leaving everything else intact... Right, and the problem still exhibited itself, you wouldn't know if it was one bad power cable or two.
Right.
So it doesn't really help you. I mean, it's a pinpoint troubleshooting thing.
Right.
That if it did work, then you would know it's the power supply cable. But if it still doesn't work, you don't get any extra information from it.
Right.
But by taking out the tray first and completely from the system, then we're able to isolate it and know either it contributes or it doesn't contribute.
Right.
So now we know that with this power supply, or with this SSD hooked up and the tray out of the picture, it doesn't boot.
Right.
So we suspect that something's wrong with the tray. But do you think, like, this is a tray, right? It's not the most complicated thing in the world. And if, let's see if I can get a focus on it. Basically, what this guy is just a very simple, just a PCB. It's a connector with a PCB that then routes to another connector over here. There's no active electronics on it at all, and that's it. So, how bad can it be? Is it shorting out on this or what? Now, if this really is the faulty component, then what we should be able to do is take our SSD out, and let's just move to it. So what I'm going to do is, now that we know that that's the faulty component, I'm going to kind of separate it out by itself just for the sake of filming here.
Sure. Raiden54 has a good question. I don't know if we want to answer this now or a little bit later, but he's asking, how would you go about diagnosing an intermittent issue when you do not have spare parts? Well, we don't really have any spare parts here. I mean, we have a couple SSDs in the build, so
yeah,
it's kind of a spare part.
Intermittent issues are the worst. Yeah. They are the devil's bugs, you know? If something's going to fail, I want it to fail all the time, every time.
Oh,
the same
absolutely.
Thing with software bugs or hardware bugs, you know, every time is the best. If it's intermittent, If it's intermittent, the best that you can do is try to understand what's the scenario. Does it repeat itself in a consistent way? Mm-hmm. Is there some action that you take before the buggy shows up? Is it some application that you run, or is it temperature related? Did you is it every time you spill coffee on it? Is it what is? Are there repeatable scenarios that happen beforehand that cause that issue?
Right.
And then once you have, if you can identify something like that, then you're really lucky. Then what you do is you say, okay, well, I've got the sequence of steps that'll cause this to happen. You start removing components of the steps in the same way that you're taking pieces out of the build, mm-hmm. and then you can identify which component or which step out of that process is right. what's causing the problem.
Right.
All right, so you've got a tray. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to hook the tray up to the power supply. And what I want to know is it the act of putting the SSD in between, putting this in between the SSD, that's causing it, or is it just the tray all by itself?
Okay.
All right. So,
is the Coca-Cola necessary for the troubleshooting process?
I always have to have a drink on stream, and mm-hmm. so yes.
Yes, me too.
pick the beverage of your choice. All right, so we're going to power this up. All right.
Look at that.
Yeah. So now, with this thing, unplug it. I'll flip the power here. Oh, wait, that's going to hit the fan.
Yeah.
Okay. So now we know just hooking up the SATA power to this guy is what's causing the problem.
Okay. Exterior, how long are we planning to be streaming? I think probably about an hour-ish, maybe an hour and a half.
Yeah, I mean,
depending.
We'll probably be done in another 10 minutes.
Yeah.
I think.
That's true.
If our assumptions are right.
Assumptions are right, yeah.
Okay, so Barry, can you come over here real quick, and we'll. I want to give a. Basically, we want to take a closer look at this thing here. So we know it's a PCB, and it got this piece of metal. Now, if you were to say this metal part right here, if it were to short out against part of this, then you'd have that short, and it would cause the power supply to go into an overcurrent protection mode and then shut down. And that's actually exactly, so what you can hear, you might not be able to hear it with the microphones that we have in the studio, but what's happening is when we turn this power supply on, it boots up, or it spins up, and then it turns off, but when we flip this power switch that's back behind the power supply, you can, after a few seconds, you can hear this audible click. And so there's an overcurrent protection. There's a relay, basically, it's activating inside this power supply that's keeping it from going up in flames. And we really appreciate
Thank
that.
You. It's right next to me.
So that's protecting this. And so if you hear that sound, it's a hint that can shortcut a lot of the debugging process to say, hey, the power supply is going into overcurrent mode. Something is likely shorted out. Or something is drawing a lot more power than it should in a typical system. And then you go through the process of identifying what that is.
Right.
So in this case, we know it's this adapter. So we're going to take this little metal bracket off of the PCB. And so let's see if I can get it a little slightly better. All right. So. All right, so this is our board here, and I'm going to make Barry's job very difficult by continually moving it. do you want to turn the light on that?
In and out of focus.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's much better.
There we go.
Okay. All right, so now we have this guy here. And so the question is it the bracket that's shorting out, or is it some problem with the PCB, or is it the combination? So we're going to take this by itself, plug it in, and then see if the problem still exhibits itself. All right, we're back here, we take this, plug it in to power, and then flip the switch, and then there, I can hold on to the PCB. Okay, so it still exhibits itself.
Okay.
All right, so now, let's listen really carefully. I don't know if you'll hear it. I'm gonna flip the switch back here, and when you do, listen for a little click, like a second or two later. There it goes. Yep. And that little click.
Little ping.
All right, so yeah, that was the relay. You can hear a relay activating in there. So we know that something's wrong with this PCB. All right, what exactly is it? So if we take a real close examination of this guy, you can see that basically we've got these connectors, and we're going to... So a little bit of background is that I used to work with electronics product servicing. I used to actually compete in it a long time ago, and so this sort of stuff is a ton of fun for me. I love soldering. I love circuit assembly. And so when you get to this level of troubleshooting, this is really fun. So what I'm looking for is, at this point, really, I would say if you get to this level, then you could totally be comfortable to say there's something wrong with this adapter. Just package it up, send it back.
Yeah.
Right. But I like to
happy.
I like to solder. Yeah. Right. So we're gonna see if we can actually fix this board. If it's fixable.
And they are saying that the ping was loud enough to get picked up.
Oh, awesome.
So they were able to hear it.
Great. Some people. Great. Yeah. And so if you were listening very carefully in the very beginning of the stream, you're like, it's overcurrent. Like, just jump right to it.
Yeah.
But so what we're going to do is we're going to look at all these traces on here. And so I'm looking to see if any of them are shorted out in between, like if there's solder that crosses, anything like that. And these, there's really not a whole lot of solder on these joints. If you flip this around, you can see that there's some through-hole connectors. This is a really ugly soldering job. So some of the through-holes, it's actually, you know, the solder's way down on the other side. Other ones, you can see the through-hole, the solder came all the way through. And that looks good. That one looks pretty bad. But that in itself is not going to cause a short. Really, what you're looking for is a big glob of solder that's going to connect both of them. So this side, even though there's some bad, bad flow through on those holes, it looks fine from a shorting standpoint. All right, so let's look at this guy right here. So we're gonna go through. These look fine. That looks fine. Good, 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 good. These all look good right here. Now we flip it over, and all right. So we're looking good, 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 good. Good, good, good. Wait a minute. Hang on. Look at that right there. All right. So Barry, can you focus in really tight right about where this little... Let me see if I can see it. It's really hard to see. Right there. That little pointer right there. And then let me see if I can get an angle for it. So in between these two right here, there's actually right there. It's kind of, if you can see it on the camera... is there a way to, can I get even closer to that? Yeah, there you go. All right, so you can see it right there. Let's see if I can do this so I get out of focus. In between these two, there's a little bitty solder bridge connecting those two pins. And then also, if you look at this this pin right here, yeah, that's perfect. So that pin right there, that's attached to a ground plane. So that's basically the ground connection for the whole computer. And then this other pin over here, I'm not sure exactly. I'd have to look at the pinout for it, you know, on the connector to see what it is. My guess is that that's probably a power pin. So we've clearly got a short between those two. And so if we back out all the way, then we're failing to boot because there was a manufacturing defect in this tray.
Right.
We bought like 50 of these trays. I mean, we had a bunch of these things, and we were assembling a few of these guys. Out of the 50, we had two that were failed, I think. So I mean, that's
pretty bad.
Yeah. But after the first one, you know, so the process when we had this computer that didn't boot, the process that we went through to identify that it was this took a few minutes, mm-hmm. And then once we had this separated, it was a matter of just kind of looking at it very closely and identifying that component. So now what we're going to try to do is see if we can fix that solder bridge. And then if we can fix that solder bridge, then maybe we can boot up.
Yeah.
So, and then we don't have to like return this thing, even though I think all total this thing costs like $12 or...
I'm not sure the best spot.
All right. It's almost like I knew this was going to happen and I had the soldering iron just prepped and ready to go. Yeah, yeah. All right. I got my solder right here, and soldering iron solder. I'm good. Yeah, I got some other stuff to kind of clean the soldering iron if I need to, just the typical stuff. But my tip is already my tip's already in pretty good shape. If you can focus on that. So basically, we are going to. This tip is pretty large to be doing this, but this is just an El Cheapo soldering iron. And so I'm gonna turn this thing on, and we're gonna have to wait for this tip to heat up because it's totally cold right now. So we'll do that.
Yeah.
And then we'll flip back to, yeah.
Yeah, so if you have any questions, now would be a really good time to ask them about troubleshooting or anything else you might have on your mind.
Yeah.
That's relevant.
Yeah. All right. So while we're waiting for this, These stacker straps, they take some getting used to.
Yeah, they do.
So like when I used to compete in electronics, that was like back in high school, there was a Vocational Industrial Club of America thing. And so as part of the electronics competition, I was taking electronics classes in high school because I just really enjoyed it. And so they had this competition, and you could compete where you identified things, you fix stuff like TVs and VCRs and whatever. And what they would do is they would take a TV or a VCR or some piece of electronics, and they would take one component in the entire set, and they would make it either open or shorted, and then put it back in. And then you had 30 minutes to identify what was going wrong with the unit, and then identify the faulty component. They would give you a schematic and a multimeter, and you just had to go to town. Sometimes they give you a scope depending upon what the problem was too. And so you go through the different levels. So you have like district level, state level, and then there's like a national level. And at the national level, you do this assembly is both troubleshooting, faulty components. You had like six different things, from a TV, microwave, VCR, stereo system. You had a computer, and then one other. I can't remember what it was. But you had all the stations. But then you also had an assembly station where you got to assemble a function generator. And so you had the PCB and all the components, and you were graded on how good your assembly was. It wasn't surface mount because this was like 20 years ago. But over 20 years, oh my gosh, over 20 years. And it wasn't surface mount, it was all like through-hole components and stuff. And so you're judged on like how smooth your bend over was on your resistor lead. And then on the backside, how good your solder connections were and how clean your cuts were and stuff like that. When you finished with that function generator, you went to a station with a scope and you had to calibrate it, and you put on one of these little things. I wasn't used to wearing this. I just didn't wear one at all. And I got up, and I did my calibration, and then I stood up, and I started walking off to go back to my where I was supposed to be. And I'm just walking, and there's this judge at the end of the aisle, and he looks at me, and his eyes start getting really big. I'm like, what did I do? And then I feel this tug on my arm. And I keep walking, and it pop, and this thing like popped off the wristband, and there's a guy sitting right next to where the station where I was, and this thing went zoof, like right by his head. And I, like, my eyes got really big, the judge is looking at me, and I'm like, oh my gosh. So I don't think they counted that against me, but it takes some getting used to.
When we first started using it in here, I'd catch it on the ledge, or I'd try to walk away with it. Same thing when we originally were in the studio, we had wired mics.
Yes.
And there were a couple of times when I took a couple steps, I'm like, ooh, I'm going to rip these microphones.
Yeah.
All
right, so if everything's right, then this thing, let's put you back on this angle right here. All right, so if this iron is heated up properly, then we should at least be able to... we're in good shape. Alright, so our solder joint that is bad, where is it? It's right there. So really all I have to do, if I do this right, if there's heat this little bit up, then what should happen is the solder should just flow and the bridge should disappear. And let's try that. We're just going to put a little bit of heat right in the middle. No, that didn't do it. Alright. So I'm going to put a little bit of solder on there. The flux on there should help it to kind of balance that. Can you see it from your side?
Here, I'm gonna try.
So really, we're going to put a little bit of solder right there, a little bit of solder right. Okay, there we go. So as you saw, when it heated up, that bridge disappeared.
And it kind of flowed back to each side.
There's a couple of people asking in chat, why do we have a GT710 in the build?
Because the reason why we have a GT710 is because this motherboard does not have onboard video, and we needed onboard video for this particular application.
Yeah.
And there was something else in one of these slots that, you know, anyways, soon. Soon.
Yeah.
All I can say is soon.
A powerful graphics card was not needed, just really video out, more or less.
Okay. So, what I've got here is a. Now, I'm not expecting people to have to go and get a multimeter, you know, to try to diagnose their problems. But just what this is a multimeter. We've got it hooked up to the common and also the voltage and ohms. We're going to just do continuity. So here you see, you can also hit this little button here, and then it'll beep. So you get the beep when you have continuity.
Basically, touching one, touching the other, no continuity. So we're good there.
So if this is done right, then what I should be able to do is now take this PCB, plug it in.
I don't understand.
You stated that an awful long time.
Well, you know, some things I'm pretty slow at, right? Okay, so flip this power switch back on. So now we've got this plugged in. And let's power it on and see if that does it. What do you know? All right, so. Now we know that it was this component.
Yeah.
It was this board. It was a solder bridge between two joints there, or two pins rather, that they shouldn't have been there,
mm-hmm.
just because of a kind of a poor manufacturing job. All right. So now we'll just put this back together, and once we're done with that, I'm going to be sitting on this one too again.
Well, there's a question from chat.
Here we go.
Kind of following up on what he asked earlier, so how do you distinguish between all your back components without access to extra parts? Well, that's kind of what we're going through again here, is that you don't necessarily need extra parts to figure out what's wrong. You break it down piece by piece until you find a fault.
Right, yeah, so that's the tricky part, is extra components can certainly help, and they can speed things up quite a bit. Sometimes you'll get to a point where You simplified it down all the way until literally all you have left is a motherboard, a CPU cooler, and a power supply. And yeah, so if you get it down to the point where you have a power supply, motherboard, CPU, and cooler, and it's still exhibiting the same problem, then you know it's one of those things, and it's really hard to go beyond that. Now there's the paperclip test that you could do for the power supply, stuff like mm-hmm. that, where you could identify if it's the power supply, it's the issue. But beyond that, if you say no, the power supply tests fine. There's even like these little cheap power supply testers that you can plug into the 24-pin connector.
They're starting to include them with a decent amount from what we've seen recently as well.
Yeah, those are nice. So that's a quick way to identify, just make sure that that's okay. So if that tests out okay and things still aren't booting, then there's a number of steps. You know, the system will still power on mm-hmm. without the RAM installed, but you won't be able to post or boot or anything like that, but you will be able to see the fans continue to spin.
Right.
Now, if you're seeing the shorting behavior, then you know that it's either the cooler, the CPU, or the motherboard. If you have extra components, then you can try things like replacing the cooler, you can try things like replacing the CPU or replacing the motherboard, but most people don't have, you know, most people don't have like just a spare CPU
exactly.
or a spare motherboard
exactly.
or whatever. Coolers are a little bit easier to come by, especially if you've installed
an
aftermarket
cooler. Yeah.
cooler, and then you have a stock cooler from, you know, that's shipped with the CPU, then mm-hmm. you can swap that out and try that.
Yeah, and depending on how far you get into the post, like this board has a QLED, or has an LED readout on it, LCD?
Yeah, has the LED readout basically right here.
Which is one of the things I noticed when we were first booting up and it was shorting, is that nothing came over that. But as soon as we yeah. remove that piece. That went up, and it went through its boot sequence, and it tells you a long way. Because I know I've had to troubleshoot that way before, and it'll say, hey, you have a memory error, you have a graphics card error. And that can be a decent starting point.
Right, right. You know, I'm going to turn the iron off, because...
Okay.
I don't want to burn myself just not paying attention. And put that on accident. Okay.
Yeah, I can understand having a lack of spare parts being an issue. When I built my recent one, I have 8 DIMMs, which is nice, but they had to be in very specific slots. And when I put them in, I was testing and moving. I got to the point where I had 7 of 8 working, and it didn't matter what slots they were in, but only 7 of 8 were in. But then I flipped 2 of them, and it was like, boop, it worked. Mm-hmm. And I think part of the issue there may have been, like, I had 4 sets of 2 kits, and sometimes, you know, they're made to work together, so.
Yeah.
It can be all sorts of things, but, yeah. That's why I try to recommend, if you can, like, go with 2 sticks of RAM, like 2x4 if you're going to do an 8 gig, just so you have that backup to troubleshoot with.
Yeah. It was interesting. We actually had we had another one of these builds, so we built multiple of these. Mm-hmm. And one of the builds that we put together was only detecting half the RAM. And so we were able to, we were fortunate in that we had a spare motherboard. We were able to test that RAM, or sorry, not spare motherboard. We had another build right next to it that was identical. And so really, it was. It's very simple to just kind of take piece by piece and swap piece by piece out into the working system until the working system stopped working.
Right.
What we found was that we had our motherboard was the culprit. I forgot to put this evil contraption thing.
Did you lose one of your posts?
Yes, I did. That's because it hates me. It fell out, and I was trying to get back in. I couldn't wedge it in. I was just like, forget it. I don't care. But anyway, so we got it all the way down to the point where it was. We knew that it was something with the motherboard, and we did a closer inspection on it. And we were about to get ready to RMA it. And I said, wait, we're gonna look. If we're gonna RMA this thing, we got to make sure that there's no bent CPU pins. Because if you try to RMA a motherboard with bad CPU pins, then they'll reject it.
Yeah.
Well, as we were looking at it, we noticed, hey, what do you know? There's some bent CPU pins on the motherboard. And, so being kind of the shop that we are, we like to have a microscope on hand.
Mm-hmm.
And so I got the microscope out, got the little pick out, and was able to bend the CPU pins back into the proper orientation.
Oh yeah.
And after we did that, we got our memory channels back.
Yeah.
So it was kind of funny. Sometimes
it's never happened on a build guide before either. That a pin is an accidentally bent. Never, ever happened.
No. It must have come from the factory. That
way. Yeah, it must have.
But yeah, so it's kind of funny because it's like you bend some pins on the CPU, like the thing won't boot.
Right.
You bend other pins, and then like maybe it's the USB that doesn't work, or maybe it's a PCI slot that doesn't work. In this case, it was, hey, we lost 2 memory channels.
Yep.
And we kept wondering, like, is it a RAM? Is it, you know, what's going on? But all right, so we got all this plugged in. Everything's back the way it was. So let's see. Does it boot? Voila.
All right.
Voila.
Look at that.
All right. So now we're powering on. We could, if we wanted to, hook up a display. Oh, you know what? We didn't put the video card back in.
Yep. We'll do that.
Right.
Do you want me to grab the HDMI cable too?
Yeah, while I'm plugging this in. Why don't you grab that and then we'll get the display up front. Then.
Yeah.
Yeah, this video card being the powerhouse that it is, has a VGA connector on it.
That's the only video out for my NAS.
Yeah, I'll slide this over.
And stepping up and bending in front of all of these here. Let me get the cable off from under there.
Oh, yeah. Put it back in, too.
Oh, yeah. I'll trade you. There we go.
So we have not rehearsed this part, so we'll see if this...
I'll do my part and hold this up. Where's that Gatorade?
No, you can lay it flat. It's fine.
Oh, okay.
I got the camera.
Top. Yeah.
All right. It's plugged in, Barry.
Nah, unplugged it.
Oh, okay.
I was about to have a makeshift monitor stand.
Is it on?
Okay, yeah, great.
Yeah. So let's try powering this on now.
Oh.
Sneak that over as close as we can.
And what do we got? There we go.
There we go.
I was like,
yeah.
Every time it takes a long time, I'm like, oh man, we have this video on troubleshooting, and then what do you know? Like, it doesn't work.
Yep.
But actually, it does work. So we're booted. We're good. Basically, this thing is waiting for an operating system at this point in time. Mm-hmm. So that's it. So we were able to go from, we have a system that that, you know, for all intents and purposes looks like. Looks like we have a bad power supply.
Right.
To actually, it had nothing to do with the power supply. It had to do with a drive tray.
Yeah.
You know, a drive tray adapter. So, just one of those things where it's like, yeah, just go through the process systematically, simplify the system as much as possible. Mm-hmm. Try not to make any assumptions about it's going to be this component or this component, and after you simplified everything down, then think about what you're going to return. But don't go and say, I'm going to start RMA components right and left until you have a working system, because that's going to chew up a lot of time. Depending upon the retailers that you're working with, it may chew up a lot of money.
Yeah.
And yeah. Great. Well, thank you so much for joining us today, and I hope you enjoyed it.
Yeah, thanks for coming.
All right, and we will see you next time. All right. Bye.